your health coach Rahul Patil. We are on the topic of discussing what's wrong with wheat and what's wrong with modern wheat. That's the right question. Another aspect of wheat that is not good for us is something called lectin. We humans have an immune system. That immune system fights against any foreign object. It can be a virus, it can be bacteria, it can be something that we eat. But our body starts reacting to it and it fights it. The reaction can be fever, loose motions, etc. Now plants also have their own system, their own immune system to fight against whatever is trying to eat them. Yeah. So wheat, being a seed, also has its own fighting system. And a part of that fighting system is called lectin. Now wheat has something called wheat germ agglutinin. Yeah, let's start calling it WGA. So this WGA is a form of lectin. Now in the plant kingdom, even spinach has a lectin, which is on the lower end or the other extreme end of the lectins, which is less poisonous. If we have to go to the what is most poisonous in the lectins, then castor oil seeds are the most. They have a lectin called ricin, which is most poisonous. A 2-3 grain size of ricin, concentrated ricin, can kill a human being. Now you will ask me, where does wheat germ agglutinin, that is the lectin of wheats, stand? Wheat germ agglutinin stands somewhere in between a spinach lectin and ricin, that's the castor oil seed lectin. Yeah. So wheat germ agglutinin, which is a lectin from wheat, is also poisonous, but it is somewhere in between. Now what does wheat germ agglutinin have an effect on human beings? Now let's try and understand the lectin from wheat, how it affects human beings. Wheat germ agglutinin is not digestible by humans. So moment we eat any wheat product, whether it's in the flour form, chapatis or bread, or whole grains, the effect is same. WGA is very, very small. It goes inside our stomach. Our stomach acid, which under normal circumstances can also burn human fingers, it is that concentrated. It has no effect on WGA or wheat germ agglutinin, the lectin of wheat. It has no effect on that. Then wheat germ agglutinin passes through the stomach acid into your small intestine, and it has a damaging effect on the inner lining of your intestine. So over a period of years, as we are eating wheat, it not only damages the inner lining of the small intestine. Now imagine, our small intestine is about 21 feet long, and how long it will take to damage the entire 21 feet long small intestine. If the small intestine is spread out, it is as big as a tennis court. Can you imagine that? It's that big. So something to cause damage to such a big part takes years. So initially, as children don't realize that wheat is damaging their small intestine. It only, the effects only start coming out after few years. But today as a population, because we are eating wheat constantly, we are eating wheat in breakfast, breakfast cereals, lunch, dinner, snacks in between, everything is full of wheat. Wheat, either the products are directly made of wheat, or there is some ingredient which is made from wheat, which is present in wheat-free products. So we have to really micromanage the damage that we are creating on our health and our small intestines or our stomach or on our entire health. So let's understand what's happening. This WGA, it keeps on damaging your small intestinal lining throughout your life if you're eating wheat all the time. But it also becomes food for the bad bacteria inside your stomach. Now the result of it being the food for the bad bacteria in your stomach is dysbiosis. The number of bad bacteria in your small intestine or in your colon multiply. Over a period of years, you will start realizing that you are having a lot of bloating, you may be having gases, you may have irritable bowel syndrome, you may start getting loose motions, you might start suddenly becoming sensitive to food. So without understanding what is happening, and you might blame age for that, you might blame genetics for that, or you might just blame bad luck for that. But we don't understand why these things suddenly start happening to us in the age of 30s or 40s. But we all do experience that. But this is nothing but a slow damage, or it's like a slow poisoning effect of wheat. And this is just one aspect of wheat. So this not only damages the inner lining, over a period of years, the filtering system of your small intestine through which the nutrients pass and come into your blood lining starts increasing. The gap into your small, the villi gap in the small intestine, which is a filtering system for the nutrients to come inside your bloodstream, now starts increasing, the size increases. Now when the size, the filter size increases of your small intestines, foreign objects or even regular food which is of larger size starts entering your bloodstream along with WGA, gliadin, all the bad bacteria present over there, and your immune system now has to fight everything that is entering through the filtering system, which is allowing larger particles along with the bacteria, virus or the other poisonous things to enter your bloodstream. Now, just imagine the autoimmune system, your immune system is now acting. Now, if this immune system stays active or inflamed for over a period of time or years, what happens? You develop chronic inflammation. And as a result of chronic inflammation, what can happen? We have understood that before also, but let me again revise it for you. Chronic inflammation, because of all these foreign particles coming inside, can lead to diabetes, heart disease, autoimmune conditions, etc., etc. It can also lead to eczema, psoriasis, skin conditions, allergic conditions. So a lot of times people have allergic reactions without understanding what they have had. This can be the root cause of it. So let's try and understand how we can help each other, or how we can help to the entire population by just getting rid of wheat. I have been able to help many people by putting them on a gluten-free diet, by micromanaging, helping them get rid of their allergic conditions, get rid of their inflammatory conditions by simply taking them off wheat. What else wheat germ agglutinin can be doing? When the filtering system of your small intestines, the size of your filter increases, the other protein molecules like the wheat germ agglutinin also is a protein, gliadin from wheat also is a protein, enters your bloodstream, and your autoimmune condition starts creating antibodies for these proteins. Now, these are not the only proteins present in your body. If there are similar proteins present in your body, for example, people who are genetically predisposed to getting hypothyroid, thyroid gland also is covered with proteins. So if your antibodies are looking at your thyroid proteins as the proteins to be fought with or attacked, your autoimmune condition or your own system will start attacking your thyroid gland. And over a period of years, you will develop a condition called hypothyroid. If your autoimmune, your own system, which is fighting against these proteins, finds some proteins which are similar somewhere else in the body, it will start attacking your own body. So it's very, very important to cut this inflammation at its roots. First step in reducing the inflammation is stopping to eat wheat. What else can wheat germ agglutinin do to you? It also has the ability to block your gallbladder. Moment it blocks your gallbladder, it blocks bile juice, which is an important factor as far as breaking down fat is concerned. And if your fat breaking capacity is involved over here or gets limited, then the fat soluble vitamins also will be blocked for absorption. So you will be deficient in vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E and vitamin K, which are all fat soluble vitamins. So WGA not only damages your inner linings, but once it enters your bloodstream, it can go to your gallbladder and also block your gallbladder function, hence making you deficient in vitamin A, D, E, K. Other than that, WGA, wheat germ agglutinin, also has the capacity to block your pancreatic enzymes. So pancreatic enzymes play a major role in breaking down protein. So it also affects your pancreas. So what can be a long-term effect of WGA affecting your pancreas? It can lead you to becoming a type 2 diabetes. It can also lead you to be deficient in building muscle because your pancreatic enzymes are involved over here, which will be blocked by WGA. So even if you eat proteins, you won't be able to build muscle the way you want to build it. What else can affect? WGA also has been linked in type 1 childhood diabetes. Yeah. So let's understand how important it is today as a population to not feed our children with wheat, because a lot of our health diseases are linked with wheat. So WGA, wheat germ agglutinin, which is a lectin and a protective thing for the plants, which acts as poison for human beings, should not be consumed. So what should not be consumed? Wheat. And inside wheat, till now we have learned the effects of gliadin, the effect of amylopectin A, and the effect of now wheat germ agglutinin. So three things we have learned why we should not be eating wheat. And the first thing what we learned was about the number of chromosomes that the modern wheat has. The ancient wheat has 14 chromosomes compared to the modern wheat, which is about 42 chromosomes. And we all know the difference between human beings and a chimpanzee, which has got 48 chromosomes, and humans, which has got 46 chromosomes. Only the difference is of 2 chromosomes, and there's a huge difference between a chimpanzee and a human being. So we today are eating wheat, which has got 42 chromosomes, whereas compared to the ancient wheat, ein corn, which had only 14 chromosomes. So just do your math and imagine what kind of effect are we as a population getting because of wheat. Yeah? So my only intention through this videos, this educational series of videos, is to help as many as people understand the ill effects of wheat and what it can lead to. It can lead to many multiple kinds of diseases, multiple kind of health issues. And it's important as a population to understand this, take a decision not to eat wheat. I know it gets difficult to not eat wheat, but it is not impossible. Since last 7 to 8 years, I am leading a life where I don't eat wheat at all. And I've asked as many as people around me not to eat wheat. And I have also educated them. This is also an effort from my side to educate you not to eat wheat. What's wrong with wheat? The more important question is, what's wrong with modern wheat? And this is few of the things that is wrong with wheat. This is your health coach, Rahul Patil, signing off. Thank you.